have been doing a fantastic job being an IFAD ambassador. And you have, even more, you are looking at farmers in Sierra Leone, you are looking at farmers in West Africa. Where is passion for agriculture coming from?
Why agriculture, Idris? You know, you're this movie star. What's up with farming? But you know, I'm not a farmer myself. I love my vegetables and I'm thankful, but I'm thankful for the food I eat because I know where it's grown. And the people that are growing it are not heard. They're marginalized. In fact, they're more hungry than I am. So that's why Sabrina and I chose to work with IFAD. And IFAD have done incredible work without many publicity. In the UN, the Goodwill Ambassadors tend to have a lot of shine and bounce and a lot of, you know, promotion, but agriculture, not so much. And because agriculture is a cornerstone of Africa's development, it's important to me as an African to raise that.
I'm hearing two things, Idris, from what you just said. You can have a strong voice, but it doesn't need to be loud. You have just demonstrated that a strong voice is a voice which is talking and supporting the voiceless.
Mm, yeah.
And it's exactly what I heard from what you said. And the voiceless are often those who are helping us to live the way we are living, but we are not receiving what the shares they should be receiving.
Yeah.
So I think that what you are doing is just so commendable, so impressive. I see exactly what you are talking about. Mm-hmm. When people are, when it's dark, when you have no electricity, when you are hungry, when the children are crying, it takes you somewhere that brings the responsibility that you have to address it. Mm. But you have not only talked about it, but you are acting on it, which is more important.
Mm.
And you have been talking about it in the world, and you are working now, and you are talking about working with people in Sierra Leone around the cocoa industry.
Yes.
What do you think that we can do in that space?
You know, so this is actually, for me, Makhtar, a very new discovery. In terms of the, I shouldn't say new. What I should say is that my understanding of the cocoa industry in Sierra Leone echoes the plight of some of the larger cocoa farming countries. The plight being that they're marginalized and the cocoa is practically stolen by larger companies who seem to take advantage of these farmers. Now, in Ghana and Cote d'Ivoire, they've had a coalition to try and raise that. So the cocoa is fairly traded. But in the smaller farmers, the smaller cocoa industry, smaller distributors, they don't have the same power. So they are taking advantage of. At a much lesser scale, but equally as unfair. So in Sierra Leone, my family and I have created something we call Akuna Cocoa, which is essentially my middle name, and it's a small coalition. IFAD have been very supportive of trying to help me construct a system that replicates that of Ghana and Cote d'Ivoire, that helps smallholder farmers. And, you know, it'd be really fascinating to hear, if I don't mind throwing the question back to you, how someone like myself, who's a small private investor and with a good ambition, can attract other investors to feel the same. You know, I just want to understand how, when IFAD, you know, people don't know too much about IFAD and its goals, but they have me. I'm a private and I'm Sierra Leonean. I'm looking at the cocoa industry. How can I invest? How can I bring more people to look at that?
We have been working very closely with IFAD. At some point, I was vice president for Africa at the World Bank. And during that time, actually, a few of my colleagues went and worked for IFAD. And we had a lot of kind of agreement on technical assistance because I have a lot of technical knowledge in this area. So we've been also, at that time, I had an opportunity to work closely with the Ghanaian and Ivorian authorities. And actually, we organized here a meeting with the late Prime Minister of Cote d'Ivoire. And and the minister of Ghana, and the question was, you are representing the two countries, 60% of the world production. You have some things that you can do to be have your market much more integrated and work on the farmer prices and have a much a stronger, a bigger bargaining power when it comes to price and export. And that's a little bit the contribution that we had at that time to bring the two countries together and think jointly. What we can do, and we will do, and I will follow up right after our conversation. We have an advisory team which comes and look at this situation in this country, make a quick assessment of what are the constraints, what are the problems, what needs to be fixed, what needs to be done. And after, our investment, our team working on equity comes and look at an entity we can have take equity or make loans and work with them. We also know the way of doing it, which is to bring a credit line to a bank and say, we would like you to focus on this particular sector. So what we can do immediately, Idris, following the meeting, is to have our team, we call it upstream, which can come and sit with you and other people working in Sierra Leone and the cocoa industry and see what it will take just to take it to the next step. And we can follow up after this conversation.
That would be incredible. And what an incredible point of action. You know, I think that, you know, we plan to go to COP in Egypt. And, you know, from this conversation, I think it would be so inspiring to see that from this opportunity, our innovation as, you know, two gentlemen with positions of a voice and power in your case, can create something. Because I think that's part of it. You know, when they see, when people see Africans working together in a innovative and a modern way, I think it encourages others. So I'm so excited about what you've said and that opportunity.
Let me just ask you about creative industry. You know, you are one of the more famous actors that we have in the planet, one of the most famous actors. And you talked to earlier about the impact of creative industry, not only in more developed countries, but also in developing countries and countries which are, and you said when we were talking earlier that for you, you are seeing huge power for change coming from this. Tell me a little bit, what are your ideas in that area? Because this is something I so strongly believe, and I would like my organization, IFC, to really engage in this area and do more. What advice do you give me?
Well, I'm going to start by, you know, saying thank you for the compliments. But little do many people know that the managing director of the IFC is also an artist and a musician and a great jazz player. And you didn't think I'd tell them, but I'm going to tell them because I think it's important. I think it's important to understand that the arts is an incredible gift that we have. The idea that we can imagine something that is not there and make it into reality is almost like magic. It is magic, in fact, and it is an instrument of change. In all, when you look back, the instrument of change is already led with the creative mind. It was not there, we imagined it and we put it forward. So that's no different from where we are at this juncture. And when we look at an emerging, and I say emerging economy in Africa loosely, but we look at the emerging economy or opportunity in Africa in the creative industry, it is actually probably the most uncorruptible industry because of that very idea that it comes from within. And if it comes from within, it can only go, you know, to where it's intended, in my opinion. You know, people typically don't make creativity for money. It's a gift, but we can embroil it in infrastructure. We can embroil it in facility and procedures that actually create jobs, create value, create a sense of pride. Because right now, when Africans look at images of themselves on Western TVs, it's typically images that are one of poverty. So how do we expect Africans to say, hey, I'm proud of what I am, unless we change the narrative? So when we watch the Nigerian filmmakers tell these beautiful, opulent tales of caution and such, it's to teach. It's to really teach. So for me, it's so important. I've spent 30 years as an actor, and I feel that I've contributed to the shift of how Black men are viewed in film. I wouldn't say I'm the only one. I say there are a lot of great actors that are Black men that have contributed to shifting how we are viewed in the media, to the point where we have, you know, people like yourself, people like Gilbert from IFAD, people like Barack Obama, who are also emblems of change. And the creative sector can amplify that with the film, with the music, with the job opportunities. I feel that for me, one of my ideas is to really sink the mobile telecom communication industry much more with the film and music industry. It's done here already. Streaming, everybody consumes films on their phones. But we know in Africa that, you know, although, you know, we're still largely on a 3G network, people consume an awful lot on their phones. And those who have smartphones, it's their lifeline. It's where they receive money. It's where they pay money. It's where they watch movies, is where all of that. So that connectivity where the creative industry can be right in the palm of the hand of a consumer, that could be really well invested, planned out, and structured. For me, that's one of the big goals. I would like to have a facilities building that starts with education all the way to being studios across Africa. And then underneath that is an ecosystem that puts the films that we make in the palms of the hands of those that have the phones and such. I wish if I had the opportunity to build the same system that made American film great, which is the cinema, the old-fashioned cinema. For us, when the old pa would sit under a tree and tell stories and everybody would sit under the tree, that's where we learned. It's no different from the cinema. So if I could, I would find a way to make cinema going in Africa accessible so people can go and then watch themselves, watch international movies, use them as educational facilities, learn so they can sit and congregate and dream. You know, I'm sorry, that's a long answer.
No, but you touched so many points. The issue of streaming is so real. And the process now more and more is to be to data centers in the continent and have loop. Because currently, this is lack of data centers on the continent. The information has to flow to a more advanced country, go to a server there or the data center and come back to countries. So I create latencies that more and more expensive. So more and more what people have been thinking now is to develop local content, put it on some data center and develop regional loops so that the data center, which is in Nigeria, can go to, send information directly to consumers, which are in Sierra Leone on their 3G or 4G mobile. The second one, which I've evolve a lot, is a compression, as you know, the compression of it. So I think that bringing all that in Africa, and it's happening, I think it's just trying to bring them together. There's so much creativity on the continent. There are so many talented young people. And you and I, when we go there, that's what strikes us the most. All these kids, if they were given an opportunity to be able to express their talent, to contribute as much as they could, they can do just marvels. And I think that that's why I really would like to have your wisdom, your advice, and to guide us on that journey, because you have done what very few people in the world have done in terms of in the movie industry, and also, as you said, in the image of what a player. Sidney Poitier, one of them, you are one of them. You know, we change the image of what things. Just incidentally, one of the first movie I watched when I was a kid was actually the French version of the Sidney Poitier movie. It was called in French, Devine qui vient dîner. And it was the kind of movie. And your movies, as well as are impacting my children the same way as those movies impacted me when I was younger.
Yeah. Okay, that's good. I appreciate that. That's good. I think that's a key factor. You said it, you know, if we can impact these young people with stories that inspire them, I think there's a real good chance that the next generation will have a lot more confidence in their self-image, confidence, especially the diaspora. You know, if the diaspora can see images of Africa that are enticing, that promote business, that promote development, that promote wealth and an abundance of pride, they will come home. They will come home and invest. And we see that in pockets, you know, we see that in Ghana, in Nigeria. I think that's part of the narrative.
Idris, I don't want to end these are going back to agriculture, which is your big passion. Mm-hmm. I think that the current food crisis that you are facing is also giving an opportunity to the continent. And I'm really trying to push people in my team to think about it. In fact, cereals are only wheat, okay? It's not only wheat. We have millet, we have sorghum, we have a lot of things which are growing on our continent. And I think that it will be an opportunity now to invest much more in these type of cereals to increase the yield, to improve the quality, to see how we could invest to build the value chain so that we have more production as the world is coming out from this crisis, to have more and more cereals coming from Africa and produce with small farmers from Africa to be part of the world supply, and to have more millet, more sorghum, more things like that traditionally were coming from the continent. And one of the things I was saying, let's look at the story of quinoa. Quinoa was something which was 25 years ago just limited in Latin America, not known. Today, it's at the table of everybody. But I would like Fonio, which have a lot of similarity with quinoa, to become something like that. So this is also one of the journeys that I would like just to maybe, you know, together do. Yes. And I would love to do that also.
I would love that. I think it would be, you know, an incredible message in terms of, you know, my work with IFAD, you know, they're very encouraging in finding innovative solutions, you know, and obviously, you know, with your power and quite frankly, your incredible experience task masking or approaching a problem and creating a solution in your various guises and jobs that you've done, I think that's where the power between what IFAD and yourself could do. And also with what Sabrina and I bring in terms of that amplification in the messaging and the, I think that would be really great. It's something that we would love to see happen more.
Just to know that IFC, the organization I'm leading, will be one of your strong partner. And myself personally, I will be very honored to be one of the large group of the group of people that you think can together work with you to contribute in changing the situation for the poorest of this world. It would be my honor to work on things on agriculture, on creative industry, and other area. But more generally, as you say, to have this big meeting where we can bring some people around the table, have a nice conversation, increase awareness, and lead to actions that we can implement together. I just want to say a big thank you, really, Idris, for taking the time to join us today in this conversation.
No, the honor is mine. And, you know, I want to say for the benefit of the listeners, this conversation genuinely has inspired and changed my life. And I don't mean to be dramatic. I am an actor after all. But, you know, Makhtar, I think that this has solidified my faith that we do have comrades on the continent that understand and that are good people, good energy, and that have the capabilities. And, you know, I'm so thankful for this conversation.